It's time for the word of God.
Yes.
Let's take some few minutes to pray that the God give us a receptive heart this afternoon. Hallelujah. Pray. Just pray. God, give me a heart to receive. Just pray. A very short one, 2 minutes. A very short prayer. Lord, speak to me today. Lord, speak to me. Speak to me. I open up my heart, Lord, to receive from you, from the Holy of Holies, King of Glory. The Bible tells me without your word, nothing was made, and I don't believe that. I pray that, Lord, may give you the grace to understand, to grab, to receive this afternoon, Lord. I just want to thank and bless you for answered prayers in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Today, you know, I always thank God for what he's doing in this ministry. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You know, a ministry that always rely on one man to preach. It's a dead ministry.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes. Hallelujah. We are blessed with people, we are men and women of God in this place who can preach without the word of God, without a pastor. Hallelujah.
Yes.
I mean, even if I travel, I still know there are people there to do the job. Hallelujah.
Yes.
We are so blessed. We are so blessed. And I'm also thankful for the musicians as well. If I'm not there, those people can play. Hallelujah. So, I mean, it's the name of the Lord, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Hallelujah. I won't waste much time. I'll call our dear elder from, is she from Ghana or from Zambia? From Zimbabwe. Hallelujah. Ruth Barbara Dodu. Let's clap, let's clap. Thank you so much for continuing on the word of God. Hallelujah.
God is good?
All the time.
All the time?
God is good.
Are there any youth in the house?
Yes.
No, there's no youth in the house.
Yeah.
God is good?
All the time.
All the time?
God is good.
God is good?
All the time.
All the time?
God is good.
God is good. Amen.
Amen.
You know what? The reason why I'm saying God is good to the youth is because we've got some wonderful, wonderful kids here. And my uncle, thank you for coming to support these boys. They are doing very well. Very soon you'll hear that we've got Pastor Richard.
Yes.
Amen. God is doing wonderful things. Mama Benji is doing wonderful in this place. Amen. And we just thank God for these children because they are doing wonderful. Because when we started, they were so shy. You know, they didn't know what to do. But, you know, you can see the change, you can see the difference already in them because they are serving God. Amen?
Amen?
And one of these days when you come here, in 2 or 3 weeks' time, you'll be shocked. Amen?
Amen?
Tell somebody that when you come here, you'll be shocked with what you are going to see here. Amen? And this place is going to be full of youth from Sydney. Amen? From different churches. And we just thank God for their lives. Amen?
Amen.
And that God is going to... Anything that God has deposited in their lives, we'll command that let it come out, and that there is no fear in them for them to serve God. Amen.
Amen.
And this will just tie up with what I'm going to talk about today, and even the praise and worship and everything that was going on is just tying up with what I'm going to talk about today. And sometimes it's very hard when you're asked to share something, and like these days I'm preparing a lot of sermons, right? Even though Pastor has not called me to say, but I'm preparing a lot of sermons, and I say, one day if Pastor gives me the chance, I'm going to preach about this. But then when you are told to preach, you get confused. Amen?
Amen.
You get confused and you say, now God, what am I going to talk about? But because of what has been going about here today, this morning, it just shows me that what I'm going to talk about is what God wanted me to say. Amen?
Amen.
So we thank God for that. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'll just sing a little song. I love singing. You know, when I was growing up and when I was in school, in high school, I was in church choir. But I don't know what the enemy did to my voice. Amen? But I'll sing. It says, Enza dear, pante fo, the water so my soul longeth after thee. Worship you. comes from the book of Psalms. And as I was singing, and I always sing this song every morning, every night, and this is my favorite song. Amen. And it came from David. And why David was saying that, we don't know. But like we heard this morning from our brother, Zambian brother, that David was worshiping God. He knew who his God is. Amen. I'll just read a scripture. In the book of Colossians, this is my favorite scripture. Amen. Colossians verse 1, starting from verse 18. This is the supremacy of God. It says, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. We are here because of Jesus Christ. Amen? It says, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before God made anything at all, and he is supreme over all creation. Christ is the one through whom God created everything in heaven and in earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see. He made kings, he made kingdoms, he made rulers, and he made authorities. Everything that has been created through him, everything has been created through him and for him. He existed before everything else began, and he holds all creation together. Christ is the head of the church, including this church, which is his body. He is the first of all who will rise from the dead. So he is first in everything. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and by him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of his blood on the cross. This includes you who were once so far away from God. Amen?
Amen.
This is my love for scripture. Amen. The supremacy of God. And we're saying here that there is nothing, we cannot do anything without you. Amen.
Amen.
Father God, I thank you this afternoon, O Lord. Lord, I thank you for giving us this opportunity to come and save you, O Lord. Lord, we thank you, O Lord, for your greatness. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your joy. We thank you for your peace. And we thank you for your word, which is you, O Lord, my God. Father God, I thank you that may I decrease and may you increase. May the power of the Holy Spirit be manifested in this place today. In the name of Jesus. Lord, do not look at my mistakes. Do not look at me, but look at what your Son has done. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. You know, like I said before, what I want to say is, normally when I'm asked to preach, I'm always preaching to myself. And I look at my life and I preach to myself. So it doesn't matter whether you don't listen or not, but I'm preaching to myself. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And I want to thank Pastor for giving me this opportunity to stand here. Because it does not make me very religious or very pious or very somebody who is knowledgeable with the word of God. No. I'm just a sinner who happen to know a few scriptures in the Bible. Amen?
Amen.
But he's given me the opportunity to stand here, and I want to thank you, Pastor. Thank you so much. I don't take this for granted. Amen?
Amen.
It's an honor. Amen.
Yes.
Something that I want to talk about today is, you know, in my college, in my Bible college, this year, every year, every semester, what they do is they call us, all of us, and they ask us to make a vow. Amen? They ask us to make a vow that, are you sure that you want to do the things of God? Are you sure you want to do the work of God? And everybody makes a vow. You know? Because you know your life, you know what you're doing. So you make a vow and say, I will do it. I'll go for it. Amen? And then when we started this year in the first semester, the first day that we started, our lecturer said, what would you do differently if you know for sure that God loves you and God has blessed you? What is it that you do if you know for sure with everything in your life, everything, every strength in your body, if you know for sure that God loves you and God has blessed you, what would you do differently? And if you know for sure that God has called you to do his work, what is it that you are willing to give up and do his work? That is a very tough question, eh? Very tough question. That if you know for sure that God has called you to do his work, what are you willing to give up and do his work? Amen? And that's a question to each and every one of us, that what are we willing to give up for God? Amen? What are we willing to give up? Youth, what are you willing to give up for God? Amen? And I thank God for these guys, girls and boys here. They give up their Saturday. Saturday is a day of joy, is a day to go to the beach, is a great day to catch up with their friends, is a day to do parties. But you know what? They're letting go of that day and come to church. Amen? Amen. So thank these guys. Amen. Good. Thank these guys. They're doing very well. And you know what they did? Before, the pastor had said, we'll be meeting here every second week of the month. But you know, themselves, not the pastor, not me. Do you know what they said yesterday? Huh? Can somebody tell me? That can we meet every what? Every week. Amen. So God is doing his work. Amen? And God will bless them for giving up something and coming to do the things of God. Amen? So this question was asked in the in our college, and everybody was quiet and were busy looking at each other, and not one person answered that question. That are you willing? Because most of the people, I go to the evening, I go to work and go to the evening college, and most of the people who are there, they work. And, the lecturer was asking us, what is it that you are willing to give up? Will you give up your profession? Will you give up your job? Will you give up things that are making you happy and do the things of God and follow your calling? Amen? And this is what I'm going to talk about today. And I looked in the Bible that there are some characters in the Bible. These people, because sometimes I wonder, why is it these people are in the Bible? What's so special about them? Were they made of brass? Were they made of gold? But these people were just you and like you and me. They had flesh. They were eating maybe salsa. They were eating cassava. They were going to the toilet. They were, you know, all these people are just like you and me. But why is it these people, they were so outstanding that God used them? Were these people so pure, so holy that God used them? Is it true? No. These people are not, they had flaws. They made mistakes. They were sinners. But there was something outstanding about them, that they let go of a lot of things and they ran for God. Amen? Amen. During this this last month, our sister was leading prayer. And she said something that touched me. And she said, we've been praying, we've been fasting, we've been doing all sorts of things. We've asked God. And this is our time of rest. This is our time that we need to rest and knowing that God is at work. Amen? Amen? The theologians, they say that when you are at work, when you are doing things using your own effort, right, God will rest. But when you are at rest, God will do his work. Amen? When you are at rest, resting in his arms, knowing that he is doing everything. We always pray about Psalms 23 and say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall never lack. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. We think it's a lie, it's true. Do you know God makes you to lie down in green pastures? Amen? If you read the book of John, John 6 verse 5, about the story of Jesus when he was feeding the 5,000 people, he asked his disciples that, we want to feed the people, where can we get the food? You think Jesus didn't know? He knew where he was getting the food. He knew where the food was coming from. But he said, where are we going to get food to feed these people? The disciples said, oh no, let them go home. Oh no, it's too late. We can't get anything. But do you know what Jesus said? There was, if you read your Bible very well, I don't know which version you have. It says, there was grass there. And he said, tell these people to what? To sit down. To cool down. In other words, he's saying, cool down, relax. Everything is okay. He said, tell these people to sit down and rest. Amen? While God is at work. Amen? These people, they didn't even know where the food was coming from, but they rested. So that scripture, when it says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall never lack. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. It's true. He will let you to relax. And these days, we don't sit on the grass, but we use our recliner chair, and we sit, and we put the foot rest up. I don't know those people, but that chair in the house. You put that chair up, and your legs up, and you're watching TV. Because you know that God, I've already prayed, I've asked God, and God in his word, he said he has blessed me with everything, and he can do all things. In, you know, we heard last week the pastor saying that it's grace upon what? Upon grace. It's blessing upon what? Upon blessing, which is upon us every day, and there's a power inside of us which is working inside of us. So you relax and you're sitting on a recliner chair knowing that I've prayed to God about my rent. My rent is being paid. I've prayed to God about my children coming from Africa to here. I know they are coming. I've prayed to God about a wife or a husband. He is coming. Amen? So we, in most cases, we don't know that. We don't know that. We want to help God. But God is jealous. God doesn't want to compete with your boyfriend. God doesn't want to compete with your girlfriend. God doesn't want to compete with your employer. He is God. Amen? And our pastor was saying, this God that we are serving is a mighty God. Amen? He is the creator of the universe. Everything that is in here belongs to him. He created it with his own hands. Amen? So we have to worship this God. Amen? So I'll just tell you the story of this. You know the stories, but sometimes it's good to be reminded. Amen? What would you do differently? I picked the story of Moses. There are several of them that I'm going to talk about. I picked the story of Moses. You know the story of Moses. And Moses, imagine, when he was born, he was put, I'm not going to say everything, he was put in the basket. And because the firstborns of all the Jews were being killed, and the mother didn't want her son to be killed. And you can imagine, I'm saying this to some of us here who come from broken families or who come from dysfunctional families. Sometimes we don't receive from God because we complain too much and say, you know, I heard that when my mother was pregnant with me, she was trying to abort me. And this is, and some people, they don't even talk to their parents because of how they were brought up. But think of the story of Moses. Moses, this is how he grew up. And from there, he was living in the house of Pharaoh. And Pharaoh was a rich man, and he was like President Obama at that time. And Moses grew up in the house of Pharaoh as a prince. So he was Prince Moses. Amen? Okay. He was Prince Moses. But Moses knew deep down in his heart that he's not an Egyptian. Amen? He knew deep down in his heart that he's not an Egyptian, but he was a prince. If it was you who is living in the house of Tony Abbott, or you are an immigrant, you are coming from Zimbabwe, you have nothing, and then you meet Tony Abbott, and you somehow find yourself in the house of Tony Abbott, or somehow you find yourself in the house of Obama, or somehow you find yourself in the house of the Queen, what will you do? And you are given 8 bedroom in the house, you are given servants, you are given everything. Will you pursue God? Will you do that? Tell me. We are all praying here and believing God. We've got a list of our all prayer requests. When you get that opportunity, you say, thank God. You come and testify here that, oh my God, I'm living as a prince. Right? But Moses was a prince. Prince Moses, living in the house of Pharaoh. He knew deep down he was not an Egyptian. He knew deep down there's something more to this. There is a God somewhere. Moses gave up all those things. He did what he did. He ran away and he was living in the bush. Amen? And there was something about Moses. Even though the Bible does not say it, but there was something about Moses that God was preparing him for something bigger. And he knew deep down that there is a God. This palace that I'm living in is nothing. Amen? So this is when you know without a shadow of doubt that you've been blessed. And you believe this Bible and you know that I'm blessed. Amen? But Moses, he came out of there. He came out of there and he was in the bush. And when he was in the bush, he was walking. And I tell you, wherever he was walking, there were other people passing by. But he saw the bush burning. And this bush, the Bible does not tell us that it was burning only once, or he just saw it once. He could have been passing through every day and seeing the bush burning. He comes again tomorrow, he sees this bush burning. Until he finds out that, what is it that is burning here? Amen? God was drawing him to him. Moses was a prince. After being a prince, he was living in the bush. After being living in the bush, he was a shepherdess. Amen? This is the same person who lived three characters. Amen? He lived three characters, but he knew who his God was. And he ended up being the deliverer of the children of Israel. Amen? So just imagine you are the one who has done all that work. You could be here in this church. You are the praise and worship leader. You could be here in this church. You are the one who has financed everything in this church. You could be here in this church. You have done everything. And you are, you know, beating your chest and saying, I've done this. God should bless me. And if a blessing comes, obviously we expect that that person who is doing a lot of work must be blessed. Amen? But Moses was not like that. He was not like that. Amen? Imagine this is a guy who was talking to God face to face. Amen? Face to face. He was not like that. But imagine when they got to a place where God said, this is in Exodus 33. Let's just go there. Exodus 33, it says, the Lord said to Moses, now that you have brought these people out of Egypt, lead them to the land. Because he had already promised this to Abraham. And he said, lead these people. This is what God will do to you. Because he wants to see whether you're made of salt or made of sugar. Amen? Amen. Are you made of salt or are you made of sugar? Because if you are really made of salt, you know who your God is. Amen? Amen. He says, lead them to the land I solemnly promised Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I told them long ago that I would give this land to their descendants, and I will send an angel before you to drive out the Canaanites, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Hebrews. There is a land with milk and honey, but I will not travel along with you, for you are a stubborn and rolling people. Amen? You have been believing God for a husband, you have been believing God for a wife, you have been believing God for a millionaire, and God said, there it is. You have been praying for a husband, and a man comes here, and you say, I'm going to put a ring in your finger, I'm going to do A, B, C, D, and God is saying, now you can have it. Will you just take it? Will you just take it? A lot of us will, and will come and testify. But this is Moses. And this is what we are supposed to be. if we want to live enjoying the supernatural, because at the moment we are living and enjoying the natural. Amen? But when we give everything to God, when you get to a position where you're uncomfortable, where you have been called names, and where you are all by yourself, you and God. Amen? You are living using the natural, but you say to God, God, I cannot take this. And God will add the super, and it becomes supernatural. Amen? And what it is, he is saying, Moses, he said, listen to what he said. God said, you can have it. The land is flowing with milk and honey, but I will not travel along with you. Amen? But listen to what Moses says. The people of Israel, when they heard this, they mourned, they were crying, because they knew that if we don't go with God, what is it? But Moses listened to him. He could have said, Lord, yes, we can go there because we've been suffering for all these 40 years. But Moses, he said, Moses said to the Lord, verse 13, he says, you have been telling me, take these people up to the promised land, but you haven't told me whom. no, that's not what I wanted. Moses said, in verse 13, he says, Moses said, if you don't go with us, Lord, don't let us move a step from this place. If you don't go with us. In other words, he was saying, if you don't go with us, how will anyone ever know that your people and I have found favor with you? How else will they know we are special and distinct from all other people on the earth? And if you read the other versions, it will say, we cannot go without your presence. Amen? We cannot go without your presence. We would rather be here in the desert than for us to go and possess the land. Even though there's milk and honey, we will not go. We are staying here until God, you go with us. Amen? Amen? This is somebody who is letting go of, imagine you are standing on top of a mountain and you are being showed Switzerland, you are being showed Paris, you are being showed all those good things, and God said, I've done everything for you, now you can go away and take it. Everything is done. Will you go? Will you stay? Imagine. But Moses said, I will not go out. We'll be here in the desert until you tell us to move on. Amen?
Amen.
This is so powerful. This is so powerful that when I was reading this, I said, my goodness, how will I do this, Lord? The things that I'm praying for, and you say, there it is. And all what I do is I'll just go and grab it without even thinking that is it really true or is not. Amen?
Amen?
Imagine the story of Elijah. That time when God said, Elijah, I'm going to meet you. And go to the mountain, I'm going to meet you. If it was you and me, the wind came. It was not just ordinary wind. It was powerful wind. And some of us will think God is there because the wind is powerful. God is powerful. That must be God. The wind came. The earthquake came. The fire came. But God was not there. Some of us would have gone with the wind. Some of us would have gone with the fire. Some of us would have gone with the rain. But it was not there. He was not there. But God just came with a still, small, little voice. He was there. Will you be able to leave something? Will you be able to delete that number for your boyfriend and delete it because that person is not going to help you to accomplish what God has called you to do? Will you be able to delete that number? Will you be able to let go of your culture? Your culture says when somebody dies or when you are supposed to do something, you have to brew some alcohol. Will you be able to let go of that? Will you be able to let go in this country of Australia? A lot of people, they consult the tarot, the fortune tellers. Amen? They come to church, they consult that. They come to church, they consult that. But will you be able to let go of all those things and just be pure in the eyes of God and say, Lord, it's you and me. Amen? That is when God will start working in your life. Amen? But listen to what God said. The Lord replied to Moses and he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you and I will call out my name, the Lord, to you. I will show kindness to anyone I choose and I will show mercy to anyone I choose. And you know, I don't even know what to say. The Lord even gave another covenant. He said, this is the covenant I'm going to make with you. I will perform wonders that have never been done before anywhere in all the earth or in any nation. Amen? This is the promise that he got after persevering. Amen? So how many of us will be able to say, Lord, I'm not going to take this. I'm going to grab, I'm going to go forward, I'm going to suffer, even if it means me suffering, even if it means me waiting for another 2-3 years, but I want to hear from you, and then I can move on. How many of us will be able to do that? Read the story of Abraham. You know, Abraham, we are all here. We are blessed because of Abraham. Amen? We are in the Abrahamic covenant. Amen? Everybody is blessed because of Abraham. Amen. But what is it that Abraham did that is so spectacular, that made him to be so outstanding? What is it that he did that is so special? But Abraham was like you and me. Abraham, we are told that his parents, they were not even believers. Amen? But Abraham was told to let go of his family, let go of his country, let go of his comfort. He did let go and he started going. Amen? He started going. And Abraham knew that this God is a God, the creator of the universe. He has done everything. He has told me that he has blessed me. Some, all of us, we've never heard God speaking, but we believe him through his word. He says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I'll be with you until the end. I love you and I've blessed you. Amen? And we believe that. But Abraham, he was also told the same way we've been told. And he believed that this God, who has told me to leave my people, he has blessed me. Do you know what he did, Abraham? Do you know even the tithe that we complain about in the church? Abraham was the first person who paid tithe. There was not even a law for paying tithe. But Abraham, he knew who his God is. Amen? He was paying tithe to the priests. He was not even told to pay tithe, but he was paying a tenth of everything that he was having, and he was giving it to the priest. Amen? So Abraham, what did he do? He knew that God has blessed me. The question I asked you before is, what will you do differently if you knew that God has blessed you? What will you do? Imagine Abraham when he was with Lot, when they had reached a time, you know the story of Abraham, but when they had reached a time when they were supposed to part, him and the Lot, amen? You know what he said? Let's go to the scripture. It's in Genesis what? Mommy is helping me. Okay. It's in Genesis 13. Amen? They had an argument because these people, they were so rich. Right? Genesis 13. Let's read from chapter 10. From chapter 8. He said, then Abraham talked it over with Lot. This arguing between our husbands has got to stop, he said. After all, we are close relatives. I tell you what we'll do. Take your choice of any section of the land you want, and we'll separate. If you want that area over there, then I'll stay here. If you want to stay in this area, then I'll move on to another place. Come on, guys. Come on, guys, you are the one who is anointed. You are the one who is blessed. You are the one who God has said, I've blessed you. How will you say to somebody, choose what you want, if you want to go there? Because what he is saying here is, it does not matter where I am. God can bless me anywhere. Amen. Even if I want to go to Switzerland, God will bless me. Even if I decide to go to Zimbabwe today, God will bless me there. That's what he's saying here. He's saying, and wherever I go, and wherever, in any situation, in any church that I am in, God will bless me there. Amen? It does not matter that the church is for 10 people. God will bless me in that church. And because of me, God will bless that church. Amen? And he said, Lord took a long look at the fertile plains of the Jordan Valley in the direction of the soul. Of course, Lord will be like a lot of us. You are told to choose. What will you do? Obviously, if I'm told to choose, I'll choose in, I don't know, the areas, some of those areas near the beach, and say that's what I want. But to a person who knows who his body is, you say it doesn't matter. Even if I'm given an old house, even if I'm told to go and live in St. Mary's, even if I'm told to go and live on a farm, God is going to bless me, and people are going to come to me in Jesus' name. And he said, the whole area was well watered everywhere, like the garden of the Lord or the beautiful land of Egypt. This was before the Lord had destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. And the Lord chose that land for himself. How selfish. The Jordan Valley to the east of them. He went there with his flocks and servants and parted company with his uncle Abraham. So while Abraham stayed in the land of Canaan, Lot moved his tents to a place near Sodom among the cities of the plain. Listen to what happened to Abraham. After Lot was born, there are some people who are supposed to get out of your life. Amen. So that you can be blessed. Amen. These people are supposed to go. So don't even argue if they want to go, let them go. If it's a boyfriend who wants to go, let him go. If it's a girlfriend who wants to go, let him go. So that God can bless you. Amen. And he said, after Lot was born, the Lord said to Abraham, hallelujah. So God could not talk to Abraham because there was somebody here. He said, look. Look, just look, as far as you can see, in every direction, oh my goodness, I'm going to give all this land to you and your offspring as a permanent possession. What else do you want? What else do you want? If Abraham had chosen to go where Lot went, you'd have missed it. You'd have missed it. I tell you, let me tell you one story that happened to my own father. My father, where he was born, his father had 12 wives. And my father saw, he was blessed though. But his father, my grandfather, my father didn't like the way his mother was living with the other women, because they used to fight for their husband. Because they used to have duties. Like 1 week with this woman, 1 week with this woman. And they used to fight. I know it's not going to happen to all of us. Amen? But my father, when he saw that, he didn't like it. And it pushed him, it forced him to go to a missionary college to study the Bible. Amen? And he was still a boy. And he said, he was telling us that I swore and I made a covenant with God that, God, I don't like what I'm seeing, what my mother is going through. And I swear with you that I will never, never have two wives.
Amen.
I just want, give me a woman that I will love for the rest of my life. Give me a beautiful woman who will give me beautiful children. Give me a woman that I will look at and I will love her, and she will love me. Amen? And we come from that woman. Amen.
Amen.
And my father, he went to a Bible college. When he went to a Bible college, he was still a boy. When he went to a Bible college, he was studying, he was a powerful man of God, my father. And that he was going to Uniting Church, Methodist Church in Zimbabwe. And at that time, I don't know who knows Bishop Muzore was, you know him. And my father, he was not married, but this other guy I'm talking about was married. So now they wanted to appoint a bishop to go to America, amen? To go and further his studies. So they were called to the office, and he was told that, Mr. So-and-so, we want to take you to America so that we you further your education, and then you become the first bishop of Zimbabwe. Amen? And then they were excited. And he went home. He went home, and because of what he had vowed, and he was doing the things of God,